Good afternoon, friends. I think after hearing an exhilarating oration by the chairman of GCDC, I am trying to make an effort to present to you a journey, a search for a holy grail, still far away. And before I start the journey, I think it's my privilege and responsibility to thank the members of the scientific committee who have been kind enough to bestow this prestigious GCDC oration to me for this year. I would like to thank in particular Dr. Jyotirmay Paul and Dr. Amal Banerjee, who were instrumental and who informed me about this honor. I would start with this, that a person who finds a cure for diabetes would have a threefold benefit. A, he will have an immaculate name which will be written down the history for his salvation of the human race. Two, he will have enough of money which will be overflowing in his bank lockers. The third advantage he will have is that he will be one of the Nobel laureates for having done this to the human beings. We have a literally tsunami of diabetes. Nearly 422 million people worldwide are sentenced to lifelong medication. The number of people from 2008 to 2014 have exponentially increased over the years. The global prevalence of diabetes, which was around 4.7% in the 80s, has gone up to 8.5% in 2014. The predominant increase of diabetic people has taken place in middle and low income group of countries. Unfortunately, it is little cheaper to treat diabetes than its associated complications like heart attack, stroke, lower limb amputation, blindness, and approximately 1.6 million deaths were reported in the year 2016. And it is estimated that 1 in 7 persons will have diabetes and shall die of diabetes due to a cardiovascular cause. The search by science is that not only to manage the diabetes but to cure it. This particular graph, which you can see, that over the years we have had the introduction of various compounds for the management of diabetes. It is nearly about a century that the insulin was recovered and put to use in a patient, when people claimed that probably that will be the cure, but unfortunately that was not to be. And last 60 years, we are using metformin. And in the last decade, we have a series of new medications which are available to us. The various organ systems which are involved, through which the control of diabetes mellitus is achieved, is shown in this particular diagram, which you all very well know. It is the pancreas, it is the gut, it is liver, muscle, brain, and even to the extent that kidneys have now been used as a source of treatment of diabetes mellitus. To classify these drugs, I think you all very well know, we have insulin secretagogues, sensitizers, alpha glucosidase inhibitors, DPP-4 inhibitors, SGLT2 inhibitors, and others. Then we have that panacea which was thought in 1922, that is insulin, and various modifications in the insulin which have taken place. And the last, one of the important drugs which has come from the gut is the GLP-1 analog. Based on this, the diabetes care, Standard of Diabetes Care 2019, published in the American Journal Diabetes Care, we find the principles are all well known to you. First is, let us prevent the occurrence of diabetes. Then once diabetes is diagnosed, we try and classify and diagnose correctly the diabetes mellitus, because the treatment varies. Then prevention and delay of the complications of type 2 diabetes. Comprehensive medical evaluation, because all organs in the body from head to toe are involved in diabetes. And then lifestyle management. We have I have been presented by a book by Dr. Samar Banerjee this afternoon, written on lifestyle management. It's this thick book, so you have to understand that today lifestyle management is an important component of management of diabetes. Then we have set for ourselves certain targets, both about the level of glucose and the 3-monthly average HbA1c. We have to fix them, use diabetes technology. So then apply the pharmacological approaches to glycemic control and management of special conditions of diabetes, like pregnancy, like malignancy, and then the complications have to be taken care of. So we need to have still a better level of care, because it is from 30%, that is one third, to practically half patients who do not meet their target of A1C, blood pressure, and the lipid levels in the body. Only 14% of patients achieve the target on all these fronts, along with a non-smoking status. Cardiovascular disease still continues to haunt diabetes, though we have certain controlling factors, but unfortunately, they still are not enough. System levels improvement are absolutely necessary so that we could make the treatment of diabetes easy and simple. This is the circle which is reproduced from the standard of care from the 19th and it shows again the same points which we enumerated. Assess the key patient characteristics, consider specific factors which impact on the choice of treatment, share decision making. I think this is a lifelong disease, therefore share decision between the patient and the doctor is agree on a management plan and then implement that plan, and ongoing monitoring and support is required because you need to have the diabetes under control and then review and try to achieve the glucose control. You need to have discussion with the patient repeatedly, and the care is, the goal of the care is prevention of complications and optimize the quality of life. The algorithm which is being given for the management of diabetes, the first drug still remains lifestyle management and metformin. And then, as you can see, the white rectangles, that you find SGLT2, you have GLP-1, you have SGLT2, you have DPP-4 inhibitors, but then the use of sulfonylurea has been put to a lower level where the sugar is not controlled at all. This time in the nomogram like this, they have also added the complications and which drug to use in which complication. So the treatment goals, once again to sum up, are to keep the person happy, healthy, as well as the lifestyle as normal so that he can lead a normal life. The multiple coexisting chronic diseases, cognitive impairment or functional dependence should have a less stringent diabetes control, occurring around 8 to 8.5%. Lipid-lowering therapy and aspirin therapy may also benefit those people who have still a long life to go. Ladies and gentlemen, in the last 13 minutes, I have tried to cover what we are doing today and how much control we are able to achieve is still far from the goal which we want to achieve. So here is a $1 million question, and that has led on to the mushrooming of a $1 billion industry, the biological cure for diabetes mellitus. Is it possible? Let's divide it into the two major categories of diabetes, that is type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. Starting with type 1 diabetes, you all very well know that the beta cells or the insulin producing cells of the body are reduced very significantly. So if we could replace them or make the cells work better, they will be important. And so cell therapy is one of the biggest hopes towards development of a cure for diabetes mellitus, especially for type 1 diabetes. Replacing the missing insulin producing cell could potentially recover normal insulin production. Early attempts to transplant pancreatic cells have largely failed, mostly due to immune reactions that reject and destroy the implanted cells. So what we can do further is that one of the most advanced alternatives comes from Diabetes Research Institute in the US, which is developing a bio-engineered mini organ where insulin-producing cells are encapsulated within a protective barrier. DRI has recently announced the first patient in Europe has been treated by this and is still successful as he does not require insulin therapy. This is a pictorial depiction of exactly what I told you. That is, gradually the cells are encapsulated in a helper cells, and this releases insulin as and when required. This could be in a cellular cover, that is cell therapy, or the so-called stem cell therapy put in a container which is called viacyte, and this is implanted and the patient keeps getting insulin over a period of time. Viacyte devices are based on the differentiation of stem cells into pancreatic beta cells precursors, and subcutaneous implantation has a retrievable medical device because it will need to be repeated after a few months. Once implanted, the precursor cells mature into beta cells and secrete insulin so that the control of sugar is nearly perfect. Viacyte Goal is a product that can free patients with type 1 and type 2 diabetes from long-term insulin dependence and complications of diabetes. If successful, Viacyte products will relieve patients both the acute challenges and risk as well as the long-term complications associated with diabetes. Then stem cell therapy by Organ Genesis. This is a Belgian company which is working on creating stem cells for the Viacyte. Can we control the immune attack on pancreas, which is supposed to be the pathogenetic process in type 1 diabetes? The answer is attacking the origin with immunotherapy. One of the companies, IMSIS in Belgium, again is running a clinical trial in which immunotherapy designed to stop diabetes 1 by specially killing the immune cells that destroy the pancreas. Early after the diagnosis, between 3 to 6 months, it is estimated that around 10% of the insulin-producing cells are still alive and producing insulin after stopping the autoimmune process. The remaining beta cells would generate and continue producing insulin. I think very interesting. We all eat cheese, and the bacteria which makes the cheese, that is being utilized by a company in Belgium, which is to control and prevent the occurrence of diabetes. It is a safe oral treatment that is only given for a limited period of time and could lead patients to develop type 1 diabetes not needing any insulin for their treatment, and or may delay the use of insulin in patients. Then type 1, we said, is an autoimmune process. Therefore, the occurrence of a vaccine could be helpful in patients of this, in which the patient can be immunized against these. Then we have the so-called artificial pancreas, where there is a system to continuously monitor glucose, and then there is a patch which keeps releasing the insulin, and that is the insulin pump. Now this closed system has come a big way and is being used in clinical practice also on a research basis. The challenges for this are replacing humans with computers could help patients better control their sugar levels and suffer less in the long term. However, in order to fully automate insulin therapy, there are many challenges like how much dose to give, and first of all, faster forms of insulin are needed to react quickly enough to change in the blood sugar level. In addition, current algorithms are being created which will try to give the exact amount of insulin to the patient, because we know that diabetes is a pleomorphic disease and each patient requires different level of insulin. Let's look at some of the procedures for type 2 diabetes. Now, we were talking of cure. There is a word called diabetes remission. When we cure, whatever procedures we saw so far, the cure means that the body does not have any complication of diabetes, any requirement of insulin, but we find that that does not happen. What we are able to achieve is that long-term basis, the insulin therapy produced by cells, by various forms of drugs or immunological systems, tend to help. And that only produces the remission where the glucose level is less than 6.4 or 6.5 as variously ascribed to. And therefore, some of the complications can arise in later part of life. So what we call that as a diabetes remission rather than cure, and complete remission no longer has pre-diabetes, HbA1c is less than 6% for at least 1 year duration. One of the trials called the DIRECT trial are working with international experts to agree to use HbA1 level of at 6.5 or less to define remission. And what was done in this diabetic research, a remission clinical trial, was to only two things, diet and lifestyle measurement, and as a result of which you see that there is 50% people who may not require insulin for 1 year or later in patients who have lost weight between 15 to 10 kilograms in the patient. A diet of around 835 calories has been used to achieve this weight loss and then have the so-called remission or cure for diabetes. Then I think the insulin pump has been created into the so-called smart insulin, and this is a pump which senses the sugar as well as then creates it. Then we have the gut. The flora of the gut, the change in the flora of the gut leads to the occurrence of diabetes. And as you can see, that changing this microbiota, we get a cure of sugar. But as yet, we are not able to get the exact bacteria which are responsible for changing this sugar. Therefore, what we can do is do a stool transfusion from a normal person, and University of Amsterdam has recently showed that fecal transplants used to transform the microbiome of a healthy person to the gut of one with diabetes can result in a short-term improvement of insulin resistance in obese patients. And I think we are in the era of robots. And as you can see, the robot can usually help both to sense as well as So micro robots are now available, as well as it is not far off that we will have robots. So they are small microchips which are introduced into the bloodstream, and this is no fiction now. To conclude, modern diabetes treatment will be completing a whole century since discovery of insulin and its human use. The most often used drug, metformin, has also been successful for the last six decades with finding of extra results. The last one decade has seen many more new drugs coming up. In the next few years, we are going to have 12 or more new drugs which are in the phase 3 trial and may be approved very soon. The rapid development in information technology is also very encouraging, and that may help to control as well as cure the diabetes. The future of diabetes treatment appears to be interesting and bright. Let us see who wins the race in finding the Holy Grail. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Professor Munjal, for your excellent talk. As because it's an oration, we just comment that we are extremely enlightened by your deliberation, and you have given some insights about the recent technological advances, innovations, which can have some huge impact on reducing the burden of diabetes in human race. Let us conclude this session, because it has got no question answers. I request all of you to give a big hand to Professor Munjal.
Hello. May I request our chairperson to hand over the memento to Dr. Y.P. Munjal. And may I request Dr. Udas Ghosh to hand over the memento to our chairpersons.